He's not there, I don't want to be there. David told us there's not a place where he is not. He said, no matter where I go, God's always there. Now, that can be comforting, or that can absolutely scare you to death, depending on how you choose to live, I guess.
But I'll tell you, more often than not, it should give us great comfort in knowing that he's here and that he's always here. I know I heard earlier that a lot of people are dealing with so much within the church, and even the people that you know, people we bring to the church to request prayer for. The burdens of this life, they sure do get heavy. And my heart goes out to each and every one of you, and even those of you who are going through things silently that maybe nobody quite knows about. God understands them. He sees them. And I hope you can find comfort in knowing today that he does. And more than anything, that he loves you, and that he cares about you, and that he will never change. Amen. It's good to see Paul and Joyce here with us. Joyce was making me macaroni and hurt her hand. And I tried to convince her that making that macaroni would help the arthritis, but she didn't go for that. But I admire Paul. He was a great help to me when I was young in the faith coming up, when I was asked to be a deacon by a preacher I love, Lapse in Judgment. And Paul was a great guide to me there. He used to hold Bryce in his lap when Bryce was just a wee fella.
Now.
Yeah. And if Bryce was to get in Paul's lap now, we'd have to call help for Paul, I think. But it's good to see them traveling up from God's country down there in Georgia. Anybody ever been to Georgia? Did you feel closer to the Lord when you crossed the line? You probably did. Paul and Joyce's car, you may have seen, has Tennessee paraphernalia all over it. And it's a wonder that car still runs. You know, Tennessee, they start out pretty good, but then after a mile or two, they just fall apart, you know. But no, all jokes aside, it's good to see all of you here. When it's raining like this, you never quite know what to expect with storms and whatnot. But what else better, even when the sun's shining, what else better do we have to do than come together as a family, as a church family, and worship our Lord? Amen? So if you got your Bibles this morning, then go with me into the Gospels, into Matthew chapter 27. I'll be completely honest with you. We're going to spend a little time in the text that I'm going to read. I like to spend more time on the exact text more than we will this morning, but as God has led my heart, so we will follow. Matthew 27 gives us the events of Jesus' crucifixion. And of course, last week being Easter, these should all be fresh on our mind. But I want to look at something that happens after Jesus dies. Luke's gospel kind of gives an indication that maybe this happened before he died, but we understand Luke's language and we see that these are events that happen immediately after Jesus' death. Now, I want us to see this. There's something here that, to be quite honest, I don't hear preached on a whole lot, but the more I think about this and the more God has stirred my heart, it just means more and more to me every time I see it. I want to preach this morning on the veil of the temple, the veil of the temple. Matthew 27, and we'll start reading with verse 50. Jesus here is preparing to die. I want to read verses 50 through 54 in the way of context, and then we'll go from there. Matthew 27, verse 50. If you've got it, say amen.
Amen.
The Bible says, Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. We're not going to talk about that verse much, but don't miss the impact and the importance of that verse. That's one of the most important verses in this book. Don't ever forget that. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent. And the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose, and came out of the graves after his resurrection, and went into the holy city, and appeared unto many. Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God. Our Father, we do stand before you this morning very thankful just for letting us be here. We thank you, Father, for safety in the storms. Last night we heard that several people had trees and different things and some houses were damaged. But, Lord, as far as I know, no lives were lost. So we thank you for that. And we do thank you this morning that you've allowed us to come together through the rain and the water. You've given us a place in the dry to come to talk about you, to sing about you, to learn about you, and to draw closer. And God, as we stand before your word now, that's what we want to do, is get closer to you. Father, we long to hear your voice this morning, and I pray, God, that you'll use me in that capacity. Lord, they don't need me, but they need you. I need you. So, Father, now we ask that you would be present and that you would speak through the power of your Spirit to all of our hearts. God, we sure do love you, and we thank you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You be seated. Thank you for standing with me. The veil of the temple. When Jesus died is where we kind of pick this story up, and we see that once Jesus dies, something happens. And we're going to talk a little bit more about this, but the veil of the temple, it says there in verse 51, is rent or torn from the top to the bottom. Now, if you're just reading through this, and if you'll read on past that, it talks about the earth did shake. So there was some sort of an earthquake of something that happened. So you kind of, if you're not careful, you'll just kind of go through that and you'll see the earthquake and the graves opening, but we'll kind of miss the veil being torn and the significance of that. My friend, let me share something with you. If it were not for that veil being torn, you wouldn't be here this morning. You wouldn't be here because we couldn't approach God. We're going to learn about that. We could not come before Him in any capacity at all. And we'll see that in the Old Testament. And I just want to do, if you'll permit me to do so, kind of like a study or to help us understand this veil of the temple. The veil was something that Israel had to have that went between them and in the tabernacle. We'll see in a minute. It was the holiest of holies. It was a place that shielded man from God. And that idea has come on up, and in traditional marriages now, you have brides who will come down the aisle, and they'll have on a veil, right? I remember when Brandy come down, when we were married, you had a veil, didn't you? I thought you did. See there, boys? Well, she had on the veil. I'm just hoping it's still the same person once I lift that veil up. But the veil, the idea there is, you know, that veil is there until the marriage vows are given, until that bond is made, and then that veil is allowed to be removed because now that couple has become united. It's the symbolism of it all. So we're going to look at that, and I believe that carries all the way back into the Old Testament. So let's look at this. Let's just jump right in this morning. Boy, it's been good to be here, hadn't it? Boy, I've enjoyed the songs. I looked around, seen Eddie singing in the choir, and I about shouted. He said everybody keeps hitting him in the arm saying, get in the choir and sing. And he said his arm was sore this morning, so he just saved him a shot in the arm and come on up and sing. Amen? So, amen, that's good. Glad for that. But let's look here in the Word. Now, I'm going to look at a couple different places, one in the Old Testament, and I'm going to reference something in the New Testament. If you want to turn there, by all means, please do. But if not, I encourage you to write these things down, and you go back and look at this and pull these things together and understand about this veil of the temple. Now, I want to first look at the symbolism of the tabernacle veil. Okay, now, if you want to turn, if you don't want to turn, just listen to me, but write this down and go back and read it. In Exodus chapter 26, Exodus chapter 26 tells us about the veil of the temple. Exodus 26 tells us as God was building, or the Ark of the Covenant had been constructed, and as they were building the tabernacle. Now, what was the tabernacle? Well, it was the place that was mobile. They could pick it up and move it, but it was a place where they would, if you will, have church. It was a place where God would be, where they could come and pray and make sacrifices and do the things that God had told them to do. But in the instructions given on how to do all this, in chapter 26, God tells them, in verse 31, I'll start reading, He says, and thou shalt make a veil of blue and purple and scarlet. Now, I don't have time this morning to get into that, but if you study colors in the Bible, you'll see that those colors are very significant, and they point you to one person. Guess who they point you to? Just guess, you'll be right. Yeah. Jesus, yeah. And fine twined linen of cunning work, with cherubims shall it be made. And thou shalt hang it upon four pillars of shittim wood overlaid with gold, and their hooks shall be of gold upon the four sockets of silver. And thou shalt hang up the veil under the tax, and thou, that thou mayest bring in thither within the veil the ark of the testimony. And the veil shall divide, notice this, and the veil shall divide unto you between the holy place and the most holy. Okay, God told them in the Old Testament, He said, there has got to be this veil, and if you will, this veil was really a giant curtain. It was enormous, and it was constructed. Some Hebrew scholars and rabbis tell us that this veil was around 40 feet high, enormous, around 20 feet or so wide. Now, it got bigger in the New Testament for the temple because Herod got big with everything. But they say this veil, there's nothing in the Bible that speaks this, but the rabbis tell us that the veil was the thickness of your hand, of a man's hand. So if you can imagine the size of this veil. Now, in the tabernacle, the symbolism of it all, God says build this because it's got to, in His words in verse 33, divide. Okay? What's He saying? He's saying that there's got to be division because of our sinful nature and God's holy nature. You understand, the Bible says that God is too pure, too holy that he should look upon sin. The Bible tells us that sin is not allowed into heaven. The Bible even tells us when Jesus was crucified that God, if you remember, did what? He turned his back on his own son. Why? Because he could not look upon the sin. Now, the symbolism of it all, it shows us there, as we look in the Old Testament, we see behind this enormous curtain or this veil, the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant, you know, the big golden box with the golden handles and the cherubims on the top with the wings that are tilted forward facing each other. In the middle between the cherubims was what they called the mercy seat. That's where the high priest would go in on Yom Kippur and apply the sacrifice once a year for the sins of man. He would bring a sin offering for himself and then bring a sin offering for the people. Now, what was this? God abode in the holiest of the holies. Where the ark was, that's where God would come down and rest. But you see, my friend, because of sin, there was a divide between man and God. Man could come so close to God, but he could not come all the way. And there was only one that was allowed to come completely into the presence of God. And we'll see in just a minute, he had to go through so much stuff, there ain't no way we could have ever kept up with it. But the symbolism there tells us something, that God is holy, we are not. And there's something in the middle. Man could not approach God. Let me give you the idea. On this festival, the people would be on the outer courts or wherever they were permitted to be inside the temple or the tabernacle complex. And they would be there and they would watch. That's all they could do. They would listen, they would wait, and they would watch to see if God forgave them or not. Now, I want you to think for just a minute. We know who God is, right? The God that made the universe, the God that spoke everything into existence, the God that runs and controls the universe perfectly, the God that has the power to create life and to disintegrate life immediately, the God that's all powerful. Imagine, if you will, standing in those outer courts, watching this high priest and saying, man, I hope God takes this. Man, I hope that that high priest is in good shape. Man, I hope that my offering will atone for my sin. This happened every year. Of course, sacrifices happened all throughout the year, but this one time of year was very important. But this veil was a thing, and it had these beautiful cherubims on it, and it stood between God and man. And I'll remind you, this thing was enormous. It was symbolic to the world that there's nothing that will allow man to get to God unless it comes through the veil. Now, if you go into the New Testament, you'll see in Hebrews chapter 10, that in symbolism for the New Testament, Hebrews tells us that Jesus Christ is the veil. His flesh was torn as the veil. He became the one, right? He became the one that stood between God and man. He was the one. And not only did he become the veil, but he became the high priest that would go behind the veil, if you will. So don't miss all the symbolism. The Bible is such full of wonderful things. Take time when you study to look through the Old Testament. Don't discredit what's in there. Oh, many people today, and I had family members tell me this, we're a New Testament church. We're not supposed to fool with that Old Testament no more. Who told you that? That's not Bible. My friend, let me tell you, the Old Testament verifies the New Testament, and it links together this tremendous puzzle, if you want to call it that, that shows us just how great and grand and glorious our God is and how marvelous our salvation is. This veil, this enormous veil, can you imagine 40 feet high? In the temple, they say it was about 60 feet high. I asked the incomparable genius of our church, Mr. Charlie Murphy, how tall is our ceiling? From the peak, you'll see, if you look up, you'll see it goes up like there's a ceiling. I'm not tricking you, you can look up. But you'll see the roof come up, and then there's a little flat piece. You see that the peak up there? I asked Charlie, I said, how far from the ground here to up there? How is that? And he said, well, about 16 feet, somewhere in there. I would have said 20 just to sound like I was smart, but Charlie said 16, so he's probably about right. Think of this veil, folks. 2-3 times the height of the roof of this church. Wide as two of these pews put together, as thick as your hand, this enormous veil that stood between God and man. Don't you think that looked imposing? Yeah. My friend, when I look at my sin, I see that same thing. I see an imposing, amazing structure that has come between me and God, and there is no possible way for me to get to where God is. Now, not only the symbolism, but let's continue looking on. We'll get back into the text here in just a minute. But not only the symbolism of the tabernacle veil, I want us to talk about the separation of the temple veil. Fast forward now, you can go back to your text there in Matthew 28. Herod built this temple in Jerusalem. And when he built this temple, he commissioned the building of it. But the temple that was built contained a veil, just like the veil in the tabernacle. Rabbis tell us these veils were remade every year. I don't know whether that's right or not. If it's true, then some women had a lot of work to do. They said there was hundreds of women who worked to make these things. But nevertheless, even into the New Testament, we see here very plainly this separation is still there. Throughout the Old Testament, man didn't get near God. Man didn't hear from God unless God spoke, right? Through a prophet. And you see from Malachi, right, the end of the Old Testament, to Matthew, we call those the dark years, 400 of them, where God didn't speak. There was no prophet. From the time Malachi left till John the Baptist showed up, there wasn't anybody. God was silent. What does that mean? Man could not go to God and get answers. My, how we take for granted the power of prayer that we have now. Do you realize that your power to pray, your ability to pray, lets you go and never have a dark moment, if you will? A dark moment that means a quiet moment where God is not speaking. Do you understand that today as Christians, we have a privilege that in the Old Testament they had no clue about? They couldn't just any old time they wanted to walk in there and talk to God and commune with God. But look at us today. Okay, the separation of the temple veil. Man could not be, okay, in the presence of God with that veil there unless he was ceremoniously clean. In the New Testament, it tells us about all these high priests. And you can go back to Leviticus, and Leviticus 4, Leviticus 16, Leviticus 21, and other places you can read about everything the high priest had to do before he could go behind that curtain. And this was still taking place when Jesus was crucified up until the very end. He had to dress a certain way. Did you know in Leviticus there's a list of things there that disqualifies the person from going back there? One of them is a crooked nose. Read it. I mean, God said, you ain't going past this curtain unless you are exactly what you are supposed to. Perfect. He said, if you got a broke hand or broke foot, or if you got this, if you're stooped over a little bit, you can't do it. Look at the qualifications. The only one that could go behind that veil and make atonement for the sins of man, he had to be something else. And if he met all those qualifications, he had to have a certain garment of apparel on. He had to put it on a certain way. He had to have a certain oils and things put on him in a certain way. Everything had to be so specific. And if any of that was missed, when that old boy had that curtain moved and he went back there, if he was not clean, as it was according to the Levitical law, he died. He did not walk into the presence of God and live unless he had met every qualification that God had laid down. Now let's fast forward a couple thousand years. What if I had to preach this way this morning? What if I had to stand up before a congregation like this and read off 632 or so laws and say, folks, we've got to make sure we've got these. Okay, because somebody might pass on this week. Did you see the names on the funeral home out there? People died this week. There's people going to die next week. And there'll people die the week after that. I couldn't imagine being a pastor to stand up here and say, now look, some of y'all's getting on up in age. Listen, have you done this and this and this and this and this and this and this? Make sure you've done this. You haven't done this, have you? Have you done this and this and this and this and this 600 times? And say, have you done all this stuff? Are you ritually clean as the high priest was? Because if not, you won't get to see God. Imagine dying like that. The Catholics have taken this and kind of created something where you got to keep their sacraments. You know, there's seven sacraments you've got to have in order to get to heaven. It's kind of the same idea on a smaller scale. Imagine living your life and dying and having no clue if you've done enough. Think about that for a minute. Don't take for granted the hope that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. Think about this high priest. This high priest, it's a great honor to be chosen, right? To be the high priest, to get to go in that year to make that sacrifice. But as it gets closer, imagine the fear that runs through his mind. Boys, did you put the right amount of oil on me? Have I got this Urim and Thummim on right? Did I put the right linen on? Is it clean? Let me think back. Did I break a bone this past year? Imagine the things going through his head, because he knows if he steps around that veil and he's not what he's supposed to be, he's a goner. They tell us that in those days they would tie ropes around him, you know, and they'd tie bells to him. And as long as the bells were ringing, they were moving, right? But once the bell stopped ringing for long enough, that fellow's dead. That's where we get our expression, a dead ringer. When he died, when the bells quit ringing, they dragged him out. Imagine being the next high priest. Man, who messed that up? You immediately go to the ones who are performing all this ritualistic things and say, "What did you do something wrong? Did you put the oil in his beard? Did you pour it over his head? Was that cloth he had on dirty? Was that breastplate missing the gem? What happened?" And somebody said, "Man, I forgot the oil this." Think about that. You know, there are people in this world right now who are living in a similar fashion who have no idea if they're right with God or not. They're living this life right now, and they're living by works and not by faith, and they're scared to death that they've not ritualistically done what they have to do, and if they die right now, I just hope my good outweighs my bad. I've heard people tell me that out of their mouth. I say, how do you sleep? How do you sleep at night thinking that you're like this high priest and you've got to be perfect at every moment of every day? Oh, my friend, the separation of that temple veil. Don't you think Jesus, when he went into the temple complex, he saw that veil? He knew what it meant. He knew that it stood for the division, the separation between God and man. He saw that veil and he saw himself. John chapter 10, he said, "I'm the door," right? I'm the door. What was the door to the holiest of holies? It was that veil. Jesus said, "I'm the door. Nobody's getting to God," right? "Unless they come through me." Jesus looked at that veil and he said, "That's me." That was, if you will, that was God's picture of his own son in his house. 60 feet high, 20 feet wide, 4 to 6 inches thick. That was God's picture of his son in his house. He said, "If you want to get to me, you've got to go through the veil." Okay, now let's fast forward a little bit. Let's go back to our text. Let's take a look at this. We've looked at the symbolism of the tabernacle veil, the separation of the temple veil. Now let's look at the significance of the torn veil. Go back to your text, Matthew 27, verse 50. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. Now if you go read back through, and the kids did a tremendous job last Sunday, didn't they, by the way, bringing those last sayings of the cross up. That was wonderful. Love that. But he said, "It is finished." Now you could preach 50 years and not cover "it is finished." You just couldn't do it. Jesus said, "It's done." What? A lot of stuff, I believe, was finished at that moment. But one thing was finished was the separation of the veil. You know why I know? Because the next verse, "And behold," what does that mean? Look, pay attention. "Behold, the veil of the temple was rent, torn in twain." Now that twain means two pieces, two separate pieces. "From the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent." Now, some skeptic right here would say, "Well, that's an earthquake, preacher. If the earth quakes, things get tore down, things get broke." Let me remind you that this thing was 60 feet tall. This thing was 20 feet wide. This thing was 4 inches thick. There wasn't no earthquake going to hurt this thing. There wasn't any earthquake that was going to do anything to this veil. The Bible says it was torn in half. Okay, not just from the bottom up or from the left to the right, but from the top to the bottom, torn in two. It could not be repaired. That was the idea there. Now, they can make another one, and man's real good at making things after God's done away with them. But the veil was torn in half. It was God's way to show those people the sacrifice of all sacrifices has been made. The high priest that will reign from now on has been chosen. The high priest that will come before me from now on is now died, but he will live again. All this told the Jewish people, Jesus was the veil. When that veil was torn, what happened? You could then see. Man could look upon the holiest of holies, the Ark of the Covenant. That veil was gone. What does all that tell us? What's the significance of it all? Jesus is the veil. How do we talk to God? When we pray, this is going to sound bad anyway I say it, but when I pray, I don't know if y'all ever pay any attention, you may not, but every time I pray, I am real careful to end my prayer the same way every single time I pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. Bible says you pray, and I believe it. And that's the way I do. I can't fathom praying without saying that. You know why? Because my ability to pray and the understanding that God's going to hear my prayer is based on one thing, and it's going through the veil. Through the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. He is the high priest. And when I pray, I'm praying and he's taking it directly to my Father. And I don't have to stand around and wonder if God got it. I don't have to stand around and wonder, is God happy? I don't have to stand around and wonder, is God going to accept this? Can I tell you I'm accepted? Can I tell you you're accepted? Can I tell you that you're heard and I'm heard? Not because you've done good things, not because you're ceremoniously, righteously clean, but because you went through the veil. You went through the Lord Jesus Christ. Anything done through him, God will see, God will hear, and God will answer. Nothing in my hands I bring, simply to him, the cross that I claim. My friend, listen to me. That veil is Jesus. The significance of that veil is gone. You see, I don't have to come to church and wonder, all right, who have I got to talk to? You see, in the Old Testament, they'd have to give sacrifices. Read it. They'd have to bring offerings. And the high priest would go through all this ceremonious stuff and do all this and this and this and this. And then he would go behind that veil and make atonement for his family first and then for everybody there. And everybody's just kind of waiting. Folks, can I tell you something? I can tell you right now. Jesus is still the high priest. He is still going to God on our behalf. And he'll go again this morning. And all you got to do is just talk to him. We can approach boldly, the Bible says, the throne of God. Why? Because Jesus tore the veil. Jesus became the veil. I'm not an outsider anymore. If you read about the tabernacle and the temple, certain people were allowed to come certain places. Women could only come so far. Gentiles could only come so far. Men could only come so far. The priest could only come so far. The only one that could enter God's presence was the high priest. But thanks be to Jesus, my friend. One day when I die, guess who I'm going to be in the presence of? I'll be in Jesus' presence. I'll be in the presence of an almighty God. Not because I stood and did things right. I've done more wrong than I'll ever do right. I'm not getting to stand to be before my God because of that. When I die, there's going to be one come take my hand. I believe that. I believe that. Dorothy, I believe that. There'll be one come take my hand, and he'll lead me. Across the Jordan, across the shadows of the valley of death, home, through the veil. I'll get to go through the veil. You know why? Because I'll be walking with him. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joys we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. The veil of the temple is the Lord Jesus Christ. The veil of the temple, the high priest, the sacrifice for man, everything became him. Christian, do you understand that? Do you understand that you can talk to God? Do you understand that you can come directly to him and pour out your heart and you don't have to let somebody else do it? You know how many people call me, ask me to pray for them, and they don't pray for themselves? Why is that? They think I've got a special line. I had somebody tell me that one time. They said, I want you to pray for me because I think God hears your prayers. Wait a minute. You think I've got a bat phone? Anybody watch Adam West, Batman, the old bat phone, you know? Commissioner Gordon, this Batman? Yeah, that's Batman. I ain't got that. I've got the same access that you do. Amen. Hey, there's not a preacher's entrance to heaven. There's not a preacher's entrance to the prayer closet. We all go the same way, through the door, through the veil. I approach God the same way you do, through Jesus. But I know as a Christian, my friend, listen, he'll hear me. I ain't got to wait on man to do something right or wrong. Jesus paid it all. Jesus did it all. When I come to him, he will hear me. Not because I'm anything, but because Jesus is everything. Christian, listen, you understand that? You understand that veil's been torn down? You can come to him. You're not like Daniel having to pray and let the angels fight it out over whether or not that prayer is getting to heaven. My friend, we can come before God himself in prayer because of what Jesus has done. And when this life's over, I'll get to see him face to face. Is anybody here not saved? Listen to me just a minute. If you're not saved, I need you to understand something. If you're not saved, that veil is still there, spiritually. The veil is there. You can't get to God because the veil is there. And until you are able to get in the veil, if you will, or around the veil, you're never going to get to God. You see, the Bible says that judgment's been given to Jesus, right? Understand that lost people are never going to get to see God. The last face they'll see before they're cast out is the veil. If you were to walk into the tabernacle in the Old Testament or the temple in the New Testament before Jesus' crucifixion, you were to pull back that curtain, guess what? The last thing you're going to see on this earth is not the Ark of the Covenant. It's that veil as you pulled it back without being right, and you drop dead right there. Last thing a lost man's going to see before he's cast into eternal darkness is that veil, Jesus. They'll never see God. Can I tell you something? The only way to God, the only way to be where he's at is through Jesus. Have you been saved? Have you accepted the Lord Jesus as your Savior? Have you said, Jesus, I've sinned, and I know that now, but I believe you died for me. Jesus, save me. Something like that. You don't have to say those exact words, but my friend, if you believe and accept, you'll be saved. Have you done that? I hope you have. I hope all of you have. But there's a chance somebody's not. Can I tell you something today? He's here. Brandy sung it. He's here right now. And if you're not, can I tell you what? The scariest walk you'll ever make in your life is coming out from wherever you're at to up here. Does that walk save you? No. But it lets God know you're serious. I believe that. I don't discount those things. I think it lets God know you're serious. Hardest walk you'll ever make, but I'll tell you, it'll be the best walk back you've ever had in your life. It'll be the hardest walk down, but it'll be the best walk back. You'll be saved. My friend, you'll be able to walk out of here, and if an asteroid falls from Mars and hits you, so what? So what? I'm going home. You ain't got to lay your head down tonight and wonder if I've done enough good stuff to get to heaven. Can I ask you, I'm going to let you know something. Let's clear that up right now. You cannot do enough good things. Good works do not matter until you're saved. Read it. Good works mean nothing until you're saved. Once you're saved, they mean a lot. They mean different, lots of good stuff there. But if you're not saved, good works mean nothing. I don't care if you're the best sinner there is, you're still a sinner. You've got to come to Jesus. Dear Christian, listen to me. Do you understand what you have? Do you understand you've got something John the Baptist never knew? No greater man born a woman than John the Baptist, the word says. You've got something that David didn't fully understand. You've got something that many in the Bible never got the ability to do, and it's come directly to God through the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't take for granted that of power and that privilege that's been given to us. Only one thing I know to do when my heart's broke, right? Take it to Jesus. Only one thing I know to do when I'm worried. Take it to Jesus. Only one thing I know to do when I'm scared. And I'm not too big and grown to admit I don't get scared. I do get scared. Things scare me. It's not boogeymen anymore. It's the things that I can't see that scare me now. When I get scared, I take it to Jesus. And you know what? He makes it okay. I don't know how. But he loves me. And he loves you. My friend, the veil has been taken away. Understand that this morning. Let's stand together all around the church. We stand and get ready for invitation, whatever they've got on their hearts this morning. As we stand, if we're able to stand, let's stand with heads bowed and eyes closed just for a moment.